we start?
Yeah, so basically, before we start, I just wanted to let you know, everyone's the way they're aware, I am recording this, and this is because for people that missed it, we'll be able to link to it to let them be able to see the whole meeting as it happens, and so that they can get caught up with things. Because it was kind of a short notice. I put it to a little short notice, but anyway. So, do you want me to just hear all this?
Yeah, sorry.
You want me to just
start
off and close this out?
Can you step forward?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. It's because we've got this.
Good evening. My name is Phil Bunker. I'm born and raised here, and I currently work at MT.
Again,
I currently work at International Game Technology. So I have some day job. And that's my
name. I'm Kurt Spitzer. I was also born and raised here in Reno. I own a general contracting company and involved in a couple other side businesses with a couple other groups. And I guess Phil and I have kind of been talking about this project for a couple of years. When I moved back to town from Denver, he was talking about it, and it just sounded so good to me that we decided that we would take the plunge and move forward with this. So we spent the preceding year of today working with different groups, RAD, Trevor Workers Association, meeting with city council members, head approach Chuck and never remember her name.
Stacey Spain, she was the previous assistant executive from the Sierra Arts Foundation.
Close to a year ago, and so this project has been out there in discussion for a long time. I know that some of you feel like this was blindsided. It was discussed at one point, and we never got feedback from Stacy, who had told us that it was going to be brought to you guys for discussion, and so we just kept moving on with the project. So before we get started, I want to come out and apologize to any of you who feel like this was sprung on you. By no means was this an intentional bait and switch or skirting your guys' involvement in the project. So I just want to put that out there right up front. I mean, this is your guys' community forum here. We're open to answer any questions you guys have. I know a lot of the concerns. We've talked at length with multiple parties up to this point, but I'd love to hear anything that you guys have to say. We'll take the opportunity to address it, and if there's anything else beyond that that we can help you with now or future down the road, just feel free to reach out and shout at us. I guess I can start by showing you guys.
Oh, by the way,
that's Jack, he's the manager
before,
of the building.
Can you articulate what the project is?
Correct. Okay, the project is an outdoor beer garden. It's a venue built out of shipping containers with multiple bars, a vending area for artists such as yourselves to sell and display work. It's got like a VIP kind of banquette seating container for rent at special events or just first come, first served during normal operating hours. Bocce ball courts. It's got some turf areas for playing backyard games, for pitching a picnic blanket and having lunch outside. And it's got a bike rack, an enclosed bike rack, so that you know bike commuters can come and park their bikes and enjoy the facility. And it does have permanent restrooms, so there is no temporary portable restrooms. Everything is hard piped into utilities, sewer, water, gas, electric, cable, all that fun stuff. So it is in sense of temporary installation in that, you know, these removable containers, when this project's over, if and when the lease terminates, we can pick this thing up and take them away and return the site to its existing condition. In general, because we do have to generate revenue to be able to put a venue like this together, it is going to be operated primarily as a bar.
As a bar?
As a bar, correct.
Single bar?
There's three bars. But the thing about that is we're just working with different distributors in Nevada for those bars, because the way that the Nevada system works, we can't buy beer from whoever we want to work with, right? We have to go with different distributors. Mm-hmm. And so these distributors are working with us to say, okay, this is this distributor's bar, we're carrying their product lines in this bar, so on and so forth.
So will this be beer and wine?
Yes, there will be beer, wine, and cocktails. But this isn't a call and chain, let's go get around to tequila shots kind of cocktails. We're not serving shots. This is select cocktails only. There'll be a cocktail menu, customized cocktail menu. We're talking to some of the local brewers around town to make specific ginger beers for us, to make specific mixers and things like that for the cocktail menu.
Somebody can order a
Boilermaker
if they want one?
I mean, Boilermaker is a shot of whiskey and beer, right?
Yeah.
Yes, no. There won't be shot glasses on it.
What is the time frame? Is this
24/7?
What's the
time? We do intend to run it 7 days a week.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Yes. But mind you, that's only during the operating windows that we have dictated by the temperatures. You know, we anticipate being closed 3 to 4 months out of the year during the winter because it is an outdoor venue. So we kind of figure sometime mid-November, close down and open up sometime in March. I mean, if we have a winter like we did last year, obviously we'd be able to run it a little bit.
Typically,
7 days a week.
Normal operating hours, Sunday through Wednesday, 11 a.m. till 10 p.m. Uh-huh. And then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 11 a.m. until midnight.
So what do I tell my 9 to 10-year-old, 11-year-old? Just deal with it. Can he answer it?
Yeah.
Wait, what do I tell him? Because I got to get back to him right now.
Okay.
So what do I tell my children?
That you're living in a downtown, and it's a zone for the space.
That we're downtown. Thank you.
The question Ray's implying here is what the fact that we are an artist live workspace with families. We are here as working artists. This is where we work. Some of us work here. It's not our hobby. It's not. We don't go somewhere else. And so one of the issues here that I'm also hearing raise the noise level, which many of us are on this side of the building. And that's a big concern for us who work and live here. This is our workspace, and we're beholden to get work done.
I understand that. Yeah, I recognize the noise is a concern, and it's a realistic concern, and I'm not trying to make any false promises saying that we're not going to be noisy.
No, just saying, has that been considered in terms of, given the fact that we already have bars all around us and music all around us during those same hours, those same days, same seasons.
Right.
And so that's what, I'm just wanting to articulate and be clear about the nature and the infra-culture, if you will, of this place. As artists, we live and we work here.
Sure.
And we're writers, we're musicians, we're teachers. And part of the beauty of being here and having developed over the years relationships with all of the businesses around here, and I mean really intimate relationships where we consider noise levels at certain times when some of us are doing performances, and having a very fluid and respectful relationship in order for everybody to work soundly and professionally.
Sure.
I was just wondering how that was taken into consideration in the nature of what this culture here is all about.
Let me address that on multiple levels.
Thank you.
As far as amplified music goes, Chuck and myself and Phil have come to an agreement that we recognize that he's gotten established, 100 days of music and, pretty much 7 days a week.
Don't stare for me.
So the conversations that we've previously had was that we will confine amplified music to within the confines of our product. Right?
That's
only a breath you can get out of the way. South is the air. We have made every design concession that we can to try and buffer music. All music's going to be pointed away from your guys' building up the street. We're not trying to just blast music 24 hours a day and throw a raging party in your guys' backyard. We're trying to create a venue and a space that focuses on the artist community, that integrates each one of you guys and the things that you do into this space. Right? And by doing that, yes, I can control the amount of noise that we have control over. And we do have established thresholds of noise volume that's existing over there that we can't exceed by a certain decibel level depending on the time of day. That's all part of the same ordinance.
Depending on the time of day. So it changes?
Yes. It's all in the Reno Municipal Code.
Okay. So we're talking kind of two different things here. We're talking about aesthetics, which is a way to live by so that we can the work that we do here, and you're talking about Reno law, what is, you know, city code, and this is, of course, this is an issue, this is, you know, a split, and, you know, it's always been, you know, strange bedfellows, if you will.
Sure.
Right? So, I think that one of the considerations, and I'm really interested in, you know, just giving you the window here, is those two different things that feels and sounds like perhaps they're still clashing.
Let me, if I may, just put everybody my take on it. To set the record straight about when people were contacted, it is correct they contacted me last July. Phil emailed me last July about this concept that they had. I brought it to Stacy's attention. I don't remember if you emailed her directly or what, but Stacy and I got together and we had one meeting. So we had one meeting, I believe it was in July, with the two of you. And you kind of laid out your project. And the way I would characterize that meeting is that it was met with very little enthusiasm on our part. We had a lot of concerns. And we asked you if you had even contacted the property owner, which at that point you said you had not. So we said we had concerns. I think I did say we would get back to you with some of what our concerns might be, and I don't think I ever did. But so that was it. And then contact, there was no more contact after that. We forgot about it and figured it probably wasn't going to happen. Never thought it was really a particularly viable idea from the beginning. And that's pretty much how I characterized it at that meeting with you guys afterward. And then absolutely zero contact for 9 months. And then all of a sudden, the only way I became aware of it was when food trucks started showing up on the lot and I started calling the owner of the lot to find out what was going on. And that's how I became aware of it. So, you guys
have nothing to do with us.
Right.
But you guys can move forward, you know, with all the, you know, this is going to happen, it's been decided, we're doing it. And not a single person in this building knew that plans were moving forward, knew that anything was really going to happen. So all of us sort of got a bad taste in our mouth about, you know, oh, so this is like a done deal, this is happening, you know. So I complained to the owner. The owner said he would have you guys get in touch with me, which you guys did a few days later. We had one more meeting where I have not, and I think you'll say this is true, automatically been against this. I've been trying to hear it out, make sure that I'm not overreacting, make sure that, you know, if there's a way that this could coexist, you know, try to find that way. And we met that one day, we went out and looked at the site, where things would go, where things would be placed, how it would look. And, you know, there's still serious concerns on my part. You know, and so I've been kind of, you know, debating on how I wanted to respond. So today, over the weekend, I worked on a letter, which pretty much crystallized my opinion on the whole thing. And I did send that out, so I made that, I made city officials, and I sent them a copy to you guys. So I don't know if any of you have seen it, but I wrote a whole letter, which basically outlines my position on it. Basically, what it says is that I'm against it, based on the way it's currently proposed. And I don't see how the nighttime bar activity can possibly happen and not create a conflict, not create a situation where it's harming my business and driving my customers away and killing the ambiance that I spent 8 years building. And I can't see how it would be quiet for the residents, you know, and reasonable for those folks. So to me, there's the conflicts are so insurmountable that I have to just kind of go against it. And it's just, I hate to do it. I respect you guys as entrepreneurs. You know, I don't know what the outcome is going to be, but I have to stand up for my business, and I have to stand up for my employees, and I have to stand up for the building, and I really think it will create a clash. And bring a lot of problems. So that's just where I'm at on it, you know. I know it might be a little unpleasant as we go forward, because I'm going to be challenging as we go.
Okay.
Is
there
a way to get a copy of that
letter?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, this will not take but less than a minute for me to read, but I find out all the possible impact that it could have that would be negative on me. First of all, let me say, I think the idea is great. I think the location is not great, but I think your idea is, you know, an interesting idea. Mm-hmm. I think, you should go forward, but not here. Okay, so here's, I know you're gonna laugh, but I was thinking, first of all, okay, odors. Well, vomit, toilets, exhaust, beer, and food, all mixed together. Noise.
Can I address?
Let me just go through my little list. It's really short. Well, pretty short. Noise, drunk people, bands at all hours, perhaps engines, perhaps generators as trucks move in and out. Parking, fights over our spaces that can really
be huge.
We did have some problems, not with Chuck, but with the previous restaurant, people being drunk parking in our spots. We called, in fact, I got smacked by somebody at about 1 o'clock in the morning in my handicapped spot. So stuff like that. So I don't have a car right now, lots of people do.
Well, it's always been a problem.
That's all.
Public.
But that could be a worse problem.
Well, parking.
Views, I'm wondering if any of my view of the river is going to be obstructed. I don't know. Safety, drunk people again, and no privacy. Because I live on the second floor, facing the back, I'm on the back side. And, you know, I like to have my windows open and stuff, and do I really want to constantly bombarded with the noises, the smells, the blah, 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 all those things? So that's my list. And I just thought maybe some other people would probably share some of those same concerns. Lot of those same issues that might come up. So again, I say, good idea for a project, terrible location, in my opinion.
I wonder also about your food trucks and your, you know, all that coming in.
Yeah.
your guys, the guys who deliver for you are so careful to be out of our way, and that is just great. But with a whole bunch of people there 7 days a week, it's going to be a mess. I can't see it being anything but a mess in that little...
Yeah, it's already really challenging.
It is. But most of the people who deliver for you are wonderful. They're very, you know, they'll park the one side.
I'm trying to train them. I've tried to train them.
You train them well, but I really worry about all the traffic and, of course, the drunks. I mean, and, you know, I go out early in the morning myself with my dog. I'd be scared. I really would be nervous now. I'm not quite so nervous now, but I'd be very nervous going out alone with my dog, with all these people drinking, you know. And a beer is equal to a shot of whiskey, and so it's not like by not having shots you're going to eliminate that. You're not. I'm an old alcohol and drug counselor, by the way, and I had to explain for a long time that one beer is equal to one shot is equal to one glass of wine. So it doesn't matter whether you're just doing beer and wine and fancy cocktails. People are going to be drunk. They're going to be puking. They're going to be staggering around, and I don't like it. It feels really bad. We have a minimum of that here now. Just an absolute minimum.
Okay. So I'll start, and I'll work my way down to this.
Okay.
The best of my ability.
Okay. Odors.
Odors. So odors, you guys keep harping on vomiting and stuff. There's not going to be people just recklessly puking in my establishment. They will be moved right out of there, and it will be cleaned up. We will have security working the perimeter. These are contracted, trained security personnel, not even employed by me, subcontracted through a professional company. Early in the morning, nobody will be remnant from our establishment there.
Just sleeping on the grass.
When you said the doors would be locked.
Yes, the whole facility is completely enclosed and will be locked up. There won't be people from our facility out any later than there would be from any other bar in any of the four directions you can point.
And that's after 11 o'clock or something?
10.
10 o'clock, weeknights, midnight, Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
So if you know, our worst fears are realized, and the noise of the crowd is so noisy that it's driving people off my patio. And it's so noisy that the residents can't sleep. What is your rent worth? And what are you going
to
do?
Well, our remedies are going to have to be one of two or both things. Adjusting operating hours and limiting capacity. Reducing capacity. And that's the only ways that we can mitigate and control it.
So you're willing to do those things?
If we have to, yes, that will be what has to happen.
Do you have a sense of that capacity and what you envision for the nature?
The maximum capacity for the way that lot is zoned would be upwards of 1,000 people. Before you panic. before you panic, just the way that those spaces are classified by building. I reclassified a lot of those spaces and allocated different adjustment factors to them to have a max capacity of 586 people. Okay, now, do we plan to operate at that capacity? No. If we have a special event and do a art show or a concert or something there, there's a possibility that we could be at that capacity. And so, but that wouldn't be...
Isn't it the more the better, though? I mean, you really make your money...
That's our culture.
The 586 people would not comfortably hang out in that space. I mean, you just wouldn't. You'd go somewhere else.
So, if you have a concert, you might, and of course, that's going to totally conflict with patio that we have existing downstairs.
Right.
You're going to have a concert, and everybody's going to be driven out of the nice dining patio where they have soft music and just quiet entertainment, naturally.
Right.
It's jazz and piano.
Well, it's not something that we're doing every single weekend or every single night.
Well,
our concerts are by permit only. We have to pull the way that we set up our business license. We have to pull a specific permit through the city manager's office for special events that will coincide with other events going on in City Green. We've got a country music concert during the rodeo. We've got some classic rock during hot August nights. You know, something that coincides with the art walk and stuff like that. So, you know, if there's a concert going on at Wingfield, we won't be having a concert down here. It's just,
well,
you know,
throughout all of July, there's concerts
every night.
Every night.
Right.
Our town. And, you know.
Right, and we want to coincide with those things. I mean, we want to be.
What do you mean by coincide? It's going to be all happening together. What's, where's the coinciding?
Well,
that's
kind of what
that's,
I mean.
So like, they stop at 8, or they're going to start at 8?
No. No. They wouldn't even issue us a permit to do such.
So just the fact that you call them concerts kind of scares me. Because concerts to me is big, loud sound. I don't know if you understand how sound works, but it's going to bounce off
the acoustics down here.
Lose very little decibel.
The acoustics down here don't facilitate us or don't lend themselves well to us having a big, loud concert, right? I mean, our amplified music isn't going to be like Red Box. It's, you know, going to be something that fits well with the space. All amplified music in that space is directed upriver, away from this building.
Yeah, but it goes up.
Hot August nights, our windows are rattling throughout the entire month of Hot August nights. The single pane windows are just, you know, and that's just cars. It's not a concert. It's a great, I mean, I want to hear more about the, you know, structural design and all those tall, you know, platforms. And but I mean, it sounds like a great idea. Have you tried Midtown?
We've done years of due diligence to find a way to make this happen, and this is the best parcel that lends itself to this facility. And unfortunately,
I mean, I have all
it's next door to you guys.
So I just
wondering, I've got a question. I know I'm kind of sitting here and acting like no man, but I did have a question, actually two, but I'll put it at one. I understand the concerns of the building. My question is, I know that we want to cater to a certain type of crowd. Now, my experience has been, unless there's been like constant promotion of a certain type and trying to draw in a certain demographic and whatnot, like I brought up, that, you know, my favorite hookah lounge, the Gaba. I go there. I used to go there a lot more. They originally identified themselves as a soft, calm, chill place to basically go and have a smoke. Now they play really loud music. It's full of college kids. They have tons of beer. So the original intent of it, even though it's not the place that I usually think of as a nice, chill place to go and relax, it's more like a courtship fest of people getting drunk and having hookah. So it's like, what did you do, practically speaking, to really ensure, like, I know, like, for instance, in different venues have different crowds. Like, you go to the knitting factory, they're going to have a different one than different clubs. Are you going to be, like, trying to attract certain crowds to try to see if they want to be involved with it, or is this going to be whoever wants to show up will come and perform?
Who can pay?
Yes. A couple ways. First of all, we're not your come get a $5 pitcher of Coors Light and get drunk. We're not, hey, it's 2-for-1 Tuesdays for college week. We're not advertising in the UNR newspaper, right? Our advertising and marketing is directed at business professionals and younger families. You know, I talk to my father and his friends that all live on the south end of town, and they go, shit, we will come into downtown to come to this venue because we think it's awesome. I mean, you go down to Beer Envy, where they are selling higher priced beers in a nicer atmosphere, and it's 40 plus year olds sitting there on a Sunday afternoon drinking beer. You know, I went in there last two Sundays ago, and there were 65 people over 40 years old hanging out drinking beer.
It's mainly
Any words?
I'm just kind of standing behind what I said. I think everybody would like likes the daytime aspects of it. I think the nighttime aspects are not.
And that's what we want to emphasize, but if we do like music, live bands, or DJs, we are pushing the day-centric vibe of this atmosphere. So.
Okay, but some of us are working. That's, you know, you're not quite recognizing it as a component.
And so is part of the
vision.
You live in a downtown atmosphere, just like any big city, and people in the service industry don't work during the day.
But they don't work during the day.
Some do.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to
that.
I know you're excited, but we're trying to push special events between noon and 6 a.m. We don't want to be pushing live music into the night, 10 o'clock at night. That's not our ethics. We want to have a day place to where families and outliers in the suburban area that wouldn't normally come downtown still perceive downtown as a negative scene, no matter how much it's been changed in the last 15 years. People don't come downtown. And we're trying to push this communal public space, hosting, having it created by public artists like yourselves, from the murals to craftsmen, and then make it more of an eclectic, fun experience for people to come and just even walk through and just see, I want to see what this looks like during the day, and maybe go get a late lunch or have a beer or two. That's what we're trying to bring people that normally wouldn't perceive downtown.
Yeah, that's been the narrative as long as we've been here.
Exactly.
And that's what the whole redevelopment of downtown is.
And
that's the narrative.
Yeah, and this is what this type of unique development does. The shipping containers are popping up all over the big cities.
Yes,
and they're creating more of a public space. And it's pushing development in these downtrodden economies in big cities. And it's bringing people back downtown. And it is pushing developments where the type of public space may temporary, so maybe move 3 years on the road and no one does grab it. Organically, homegrown. So
now, I've done my research, I've looked at the different types of beer gardens, urban parks, community parks. There's all bunch of different names for these different types of facilities. Some of them some are made of wood, some of them are all trees, some of them have more urban container park look. And the thing that I noticed about most of these is they don't have free bars. They have a coffee shop, they'll have places selling, different types of different things. But here, it looks like it's basically three bars and then temporary food trucks. So it looks like the emphasis is on the alcohol. And that's, I think, is where the main concern is coming from, is compared to other things that I've seen, which have kind of like the casual, maybe evening brunch kind of atmosphere somewhere around there. This one seems to be centered on the drinking. And I think that's what, everyone's like, okay, it's going to be open later tonight, it's going to have free bars, and the food trucks. So it just seems like it's a different, because each one of these parks looks like it's centered to a different crowd and has a different theme. Some of them got the German, Bavarian theme, some of them have more like a marketplace kind of thing, like we were talking about having farmers markets there and stuff like that. I can see all that working, but the actual permanent vendors all seem to be, it's all beer. So how do we explain that?
We achieved
that with re-rotating food trucks to provide the food rather than having a container that serves problems, right? It gives the people that come there a wider variety of food on a rotating cycle rather than saying, we're a beer garden, eat a brat and drink a beer, right? We're achieving something that's better than a permanent installation.
And right? On to that point, our other aspect is the art. My dad's an artist. I've been growing up in the art family my entire life, and I'm passionate about the art part of this project. And that's, like I mentioned, that's where we want to bring that regimen-based alcohol with local artists to make an outdoor, almost a museum, but a public space where people can see and do art on a rotating basis. That's what will make this more of a unique place than other places in the United States where it is just a concrete slab with the containers.
How are you going to display art?
So we've got this set up.
Yeah.
Now maybe, why don't we ask
that's
them?
That's
what I was going to ask.
So, this is kind of tougher to see here, but there's a few different renderings from all four angles.
Where's the building?
Yeah, where are we?
Okay, so we are sitting, this is the artist loft building right here.
Well, that's one, is that the building or is that the...
That's the face of the building.
Which face, facing?
Facing Virginia.
That's facing west.
West.
So this is Sierra Street right here, and this is the Riverwalk right here.
Okay, that's our building there in the back. Where?
Right, in this?
Yeah, no, that mountain, that picture you were just showing is down there. Where the back, right there, yeah, okay. Where, from there, where will the toilets be?
The toilets are over here.
Right in the...
But let me talk about this. So those containers are 9 foot tall. So they are below, well below any of your guys' views. Those toilets are vented out the front and side past your building and are outfitted with charcoal filters. So there's no sewer smell coming from any of the vents on these toilets.
So you wouldn't mind having those under your toilet?
No.
You've seen these in operation and you know they were...
I'm building it personally.
Okay, you built these before?
No, this is the first time this has been done, but I've installed this system. This charcoal filter system that I'm using on other stuff. If you think about temporary classrooms at an elementary school, they're outgrowing all of our schools.
So
those all have toilets and stuff built into them, and they don't even use the filter systems that I'm using on this.
So one of the most classic buildings in Reno will have toilets.
Family-friendly.
And where's
the
Chuck's patio?
Where's
Chuck's patio
here? Chuck's patio is back in over here.
So you say you're building, but basically there's 8 shipping containers, and then that's the building and the toilets are... Is that a shipping container also?
Correct.
There are 9 shipping containers. That's the building. Is that building bringing in...
But I have to take and fabricate the containers. I have to modify the containers. I have to put all the electrical, plumbing, mechanical, lights, cooling. I'm putting over $500,000 into the construction of these containers. This isn't me flying by night with slapping a bunch of containers out. This is going to be a well-built, well-designed, well-maintained facility that I'm putting a lot of money and investing a lot of myself into to ensure that it's a success.
So you're saying one container is going to be an eating container where people are actually inside?
No.
Oh,
the only containers that are accessible by the general public are the restroom and then these two containers here. This container right here is a vending container where we're opening it up to the community where you guys can come, put your art on the wall. Artists in making jewelry, art glass, leatherwork, whatever they want to do, come and bend out of this container.
So there's only one place that people can go inside, basically.
Well, there's 3 booths for vendors in here, and then this container is 3 banquettes, horseshoe-shaped banquettes with table seating.
Are you
going to
create another driveway on Sierra?
So there's no parking requirements here. Parking in the courthouse lot, in the parking garages. The way that I designed this, and what I've worked out as an agreement with all of my liquor vendors, this is an access easement. It goes to you guys' park.
Right.
Okay. And this is actually part of this property. There's
a geographic easement to that.
Yeah. There's an non-exclusive access
back in 2000.
Right. So it's still on paper part of this property, but it has an easement for the units, right? It will never be impeded, it will never be taken away. It's part of this property. So my deliveries come in here, back into this service gate, and all deliveries happen inside of our property.
This is right under our windows, by the way.
So that there is no traffic flow, there's nothing impeding you guys, we're not gonna have trucks sitting out here on the road, and there will be no parking in there. On your guys' problem.
Again, we're talking about the noise level that's right under our windows.
Sure.
Right here. Yeah.
I want to ask you a question.
I understand that, but it's going to be it'll be less impactful than Chuck. We have 3 deliveries, 3 people delivering. He's got multiple food, multiple alcohol vendors all coming to this facility.
Where will the stage be in reference to our building?
The stage?
Yeah.
So for special events, we would erect a small scaffold stage right here. And where's our building? Your building's up on the hill.
Okay.
Right? So all music is projected that way. Same with all lights projected that way. All amplified music projected.
If your stage is back there, your lights are projected this way. They're on the stage. Yeah? Stage, people on it, lights going this way.
That's if we're ready at night for that.
Yeah.
Most of our stuff would be during the day.
And not up the downhill stage.
You would have that to you next time.
Because there are people here who get up at like 5 in the morning to write, and they go to bed here early. I know three apartments back there that do that. And it's totally disruptive to a quiet building. I mean, not that your idea is bad, it's good, I like it, but it's not good.
Well, if we were to take it somewhere else, people would have the same exact complaints, and I'm sorry.
Not necessarily.
We did a lot of due diligence in trying to find a problem. This is not the first place we looked, this is not the last place we looked.
Kurt, can I ask you a question about the bathrooms?
Please.
Right under my window. You're putting a sewer system from there out to Sierra Street, right?
Correct.
Why wouldn't you put the bathrooms over next to Sierra Street? On that side.
Because if we were to transpose the bathrooms over onto this side, it means moving a bar closer to your guys' building.
Well,
it's 6 1/2 dozen of them.
I had an idea.
Well, not necessarily.
I know that you guys have done a lot of development and we spent a lot of money on it, but I'm seeing two problems that could be rectified by switching the food truck placing with the bathrooms. First of all, you would have bathrooms there, you would have the smell of food coming up rather than bathrooms. But the other thing too is, I remember you telling me during the meeting that we had at Ivy's place that the food trucks would come in here and make a U-turn and show up here. But unless we have a sliding fence here, a sliding fence here.
I have a fence here and here. So the food trucks pull in and then they drive out.
Now, I know that most of these food trucks are going to not be able to do a full U-turn. I think probably going to have to back up and then come in this way just because of clearance. What I'm thinking about is Chuck's 18-wheeler trucks that come in, they're full 18-wheel trucks. You were suggesting that they park on the street. That's not going to be possible because there's no parking.
Well, I can't help Chuck's. He's going to have to deal with his vendors.
Do you think that's a
really, really? I mean, if the neighbor wanted to get persnickety about it, he could tell them that they're not allowed to pull on this lot anyways, whether we're there or not.
Because I live right out there, what they usually do is they pull in this way, they get on, they jump the curb here, they go around, and then they park this way. The back of the truck is usually facing there, and then after they're down, they'll go in and just go off the curb. They're not going to be able to do any of that. So I'm just wondering, from a practical standpoint, how is that going to work?
I've got a pickup truck that's as long as those food trucks. Well, the 18 wheelers I don't know what to say. Chuck's going to have to talk to his vendors about bringing single axle trucks. I mean, what you guys are selling me on is Chuck's using somebody else's property. And because he's able to use somebody else's property, I'm causing an inconvenience.
No, what I'm saying is that I was just thinking, the easement as it is currently is good enough for us and single axle trucks. But if double axle or, I don't know how many people are classified 18-wheeler trucks as, I would imagine that, let's say if a high rise condo goes there, they would have to make some sort of easement for Chuck's trucks. On a long-term basis.
No.
I
have to pull out the street just like they do in big cities. That's how it happens. You will have.
Hey, Chris.
You guys are in trouble now.
I want to talk about sound. Because if you want the people in the bar to hear
they're not in this bar. People don't go inside of these bars.
But people will be there, right? So what about people here on the turf? You want them to hear the music?
Right, yeah, so you guys are talking theoretically as though there's a stage music going through the stage all the time. There will be music off of this column right here shooting that way, off of this corner shooting that way, off of this corner shooting this way. Right? And so if we can zone all those, wherein we can turn off the music over here so that we're not conflicting with Chuck and still have ambient music going.
Right. But there's a really big building here and a really big building here.
I understand.
Right? And sound reflects.
Right.
And it doesn't lose much volume.
I understand.
It does reflect.
But what we have to do by Reno Municipal Code is maintain a certain decibel level based off of established existing noise levels. And we can't go above that off the property.
You know,
so we're not going to be having, I've got a sound engineer that's going to come and take that reading on an average over several days. And then we establish that baseline criteria, and then that's what we're confined to with the additional decibel levels on a
So you don't know what the decibel levels are, right?
As of right now, no. it's really
next?
Like, you know, again,
yeah.
This music is going to be, you know, entertainment, special events and stuff. The ambient music is just there in the background. I'm not trying to pump the music
up. Yeah,
no,
I'm talking about the concerts. I'm talking about the special events.
Yeah.
I don't think ambient music is going to be all that bad. It's really going to be kind of amplifying a band.
Right.
And you're saying 586 person maximum. Is it that it's an all stand-up area? They're in stand-up.
Oh, we're going to be building tables. I mean, we have a low fence area here along the Riverwalk. We'll have some tables in here. This area in here will have a bunch of tables. And then there will be tables, movable tables, dispersed around. So that when there's a need to pull all the tables out of there and put them in the storage containers to open up more space, we can do that. But in general, what we're really just trying to create is just a place for people to congregate. You know, come down on a Saturday afternoon, you hang out with your friends, your kids are playing bocce ball, your dog's running around, you're drinking a beer. You know, I mean, it's not something that we're trying to create like a, hey, this is going to be the best concert venue, you know, rock and party ever. I mean, it's really meant to be more of a community space. And you know, we really are trying and have had serious conversations with Eric Shapiro at the Sculpture Fest, with Art Tech, all those people, and working with them to set up curated events where they come and do special events, and as well as open it up to the general public. You know, if you guys want to come and sell something out of the vending booth, it's yours. You know, if you want to showcase some art on the back wall of the bar where people aren't going to be able to poke it and touch it, put it up there.
It seems a little odd. I mean, you've just named Eric Shapiro and others in our town, I'm assuming them, that here we are as an artist loft, and none of us have been addressed or informed about this at all. But you've gone to other artists who don't even live here. So that seems just a little odd.
And these are conversations that we've
been going on
recently.
Yeah.
But I mean, these are things that we've had as a concept since
right.
day one, and how we kind of laid this out and how we set it up and the operational plan that we have for the product.
Will you have any kind of cover for either sunshade or rain shade?
Yeah, so you can kind of see some of these dashed lines going around. They will be cables spanning off either the top of containers or columns off the containers. So that we just have the little LED light strips giving ambient light. And then I will be having Eichelberger on make shade sails that will be suspended around. So there will be some vertical noise transmitting breaks. There will be some visual break, but you know, it's some shades structure. But you know, in general, those are kind of things that we're just going to design and play with as we get this thing put together.
Are the shades going to be made of, like, linen or canvas or any
like that, plastic? Like a heavy vinyl coating.
Heavy vinyl coating.
Yeah.
Okay.
Steel cloth, canvas.
Mm-hmm. You say that food trucks are going to rotate in and out during
yes, so, the day? Yes, so their license only allows them to be static in one location for 4 hours at a time. So what we're going to do is set up a schedule for these food trucks where they have to rotate in and out every 4 hours. So they pull in here. This is the driveway to you guys parking back here.
So they just drive in,
they pull right in, and pull right into here. So they're behind the fence on our yard.
But I could see how they could drive in and back in.
Well, I've got a truck as long as a food truck, that's it. And I've done it.
Really?
Yes.
How about
that's a
tar- speeds? Are you talking about speeds, the fish people that have been on the lot?
Oh, it's cod fish?
Speeds.
Oh, speeds.
Yeah.
I don't think their food truck's going to fit in there. Their food truck's half the size of the lot.
I was going to say, I have to sit for 10 minutes waiting for them to back up. Circle around
yeah.
In the lot.
Yeah.
Some are bigger than they were.
That's probably the biggest one in town.
Some are trailers. They got particular trucks in front of them. Trailers, others are single axle. Mm-hmm.
But there are, what's the count now? Like
55 or 60.
Last I saw it, that was 65 licensed food trucks in the city of Reno.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, they have some over there in case anyone was interested. We've been talking for a long time with Jeff coming out with some sodas. So it's in the ice.
Is there any
beer? No.
I don't have a license.
We dropped the ball there, so.
Is there a restriction on how
a restriction on what? Yes, there is 100 feet from the front door of a brick and mortar. The furthest back, the closest one to Chuck's, is well over 100. It's way over 100.
What is Chuck thinking about?
Oh, we don't want
to Chuck's gone back and forth, and he's been really fair and really honest and good to work with, but he's got some concerns that are validated, or, you know, could be. Yeah. My position on this, though, is, you know, we're bringing a lot of people down here that wouldn't normally be down here. We're bringing people from out of town, or, you know, outside the core of downtown, that wouldn't normally come downtown to go to Chuck's. A lot of people that come down here that want to sit down and enjoy the afternoon and have a glass of wine and a beer with their friends, and then go get a sit-down dinner that don't want to eat food truck food, are likely to go over.
I know I'm totally, like, an hour
late.
On the toilets, is there a plumbing?
Yes.
Goes to the sewer?
Yes.
Oh, excellent.
I'm worried about the bathrooms being friendly. I mean, not only coming from the odor, flushing sound, there won't be any flushing sound.
They're insulated.
There's no flushing sound?
They're insulated, you don't hear it.
You don't hear flushing.
There's six toilets for
like every 3 minutes.
That's Coda.
That's Coda. Yes.
Six toilets
and 2 urinals. So it's 4 toilets and 2 labs for each sex.
So this is a 5-year lease?
Mm-hmm.
So it's 5 years with no skyscrapers you feel the way.
Yep. That's where we'd go if it wasn't this.
I saw something in one of the news reports that you were thinking about relocating later on if this turns out to be a successful venture. Is that what I read
correctly? Yeah, if this business works, which I truly believe that it will, and the landlord decides to develop this property rather than continue with us or sell the property, then yeah, I plan on cutting these things off the ground and taking them somewhere else.
That's basically actually it's essentially it's been a trend for the last couple of years.
It is the trend, so I said it is the trend.
Of course.
Pop-up culture.
I'm gonna set it off.
Now you see it, now you don't.
But so yeah, I mean that's kind of it in a nutshell. You know, something that I think you guys may have heard a bit or a piece about, and Phil kind of touched on it too, is, you know, aside from this just working as operating hours, you know, we want to make this a community space where nonprofits can come and host events, where, you know, we can set up for farmers markets and stuff Saturday, Sunday morning before we open, the gates are open, you know, set this up and serve smoothies and do community yoga. We've got a bunch of friends that run the Lululemon store here, and those girls were like, we will do community yoga there every Saturday morning if you let us. Right, so aside from it just operating as
an
office, right, you know, we have to have a way to generate revenue to build something like this and to maintain this. It's also available for so many other things, and there's so many opportunities that we're wide open to.
It
kind of
sounds a little bit, I don't know if you've been to the Reno Generator, but that place is like an indoor playground for people that want to make stuff and go on. It kind of sounds like the same general concept where it's like a common place for everyone to come and use, but it's outdoors and it's more of an entertainment venue rather than a warehouse.
Right.
Would that be
that's a fair assessment.
Your point too, not speaking with art workers or developers and generating other places, some of these have amazing art that just gets stored away for 6 months out of the year and don't get seen. You want to be able to help that and push that.
I'm a little concerned about the environmental controls, say like if we have acrylics or oil paintings or something that's, you know, we spent, you know, a lot of months on. First of all, making sure the vandalism doesn't happen.
Painting is a painting, it's a different animal. It's like we would address each piece of art out and talk to the person that wanted to do it. Some of them make a bit more piece like this for the weather components. If it's even able to do that for that specific piece of art.
The other big question I forget to ask, are you guys going to be part of the wine box and the beer cross?
I mean,
likely.
It's kind of hard not to.
I just wanted to ask that question because it's never been asked.
It's kind of hard not to be. But yeah.
So,
is it something I'm excited about?
Obviously.
Well, the beer calls seem to be about the whole cost thing.
You know, the wine walk and stuff like that, more daytime events, but, you know, it's hard for me to say absolutely not because, you know, revenue is revenue, but if we can avoid it, you better believe it. Shoot, what was it? Saturday night, we were over at picnic having, you know, a nice time with some friends, and here comes the St. Patty's Day crawl, and we packed up and split. I mean, that's not the scene that we want to generate. It's not the scene we want to be part of.
We're part of it.
What are things like this?
So there's a couple other things like this. There's one in downtown San Francisco, right, in a similar setting to what we're looking at here. It's a smaller operation. It's kind of off the backside of the German restaurant. They have another really good one that they put in right at the baseball field. Down there by the water. There's a bigger one than this that's more based off of a concert venue setting in San Diego. Austin, Texas has Container Bar, which is kind of an indoor outdoor. You can actually go in the containers, but a lot of it's even there.
Where are you from?
Here? One of those. So I spent 12 years in Indian, Colorado, living in downtown Denver for 7 years. In a high rise in the center of downtown.
What time do the bars close?
These ones are never.
Two.
10 o'clock Sunday through Wednesday, and then midnight Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
I was just curious, are you
going
to change the surface from gravel to something else?
Yes. So we've got two areas here out in front of these. It's going to be AstroTurf. Here, out on this little seating area here, as well as right here. We've got two bocce ball courts right here, and then everything else will be porous pavers. So when it rains, it all goes right through the pavers into the ground rather than sheet flooring off the side.
What is a paver? Is that like for the...
Just a little concrete. You've seen them on sidewalks and driveways.
Or is it just concrete, but it's made to look like stone?
No, it's just like a square. You can do it in different patterns and different...
Yeah, it's like they put the mold
on the tile on the right side.
What about power? Electricity, mm-hmm.
that's all in a separate building?
Correct.
Obviously.
So,
obviously, the
main distribution panel sits inside of this storage container with an emergency disconnect for the fire department, obviously. And then each of the bars has a sub panel, and then these two containers are, well, and the bathroom has a sub panel, and these two containers are powered just straight off.
Will that be like generators?
No, it's all connected to any energy.
So
everything's
no noise.
No noise. Everything is exactly like if it was a permanent building, a permanent structure. It's all.
We've had power outages in our generator.
Yeah.
We don't have a backup generator, so.
So it's that, not, that's no, it. That's it. Okay, that was a question.
And you know, to alleviate that with food trucks and stuff, those guys set up and pair up their generators. I put permanent power pedestals here so that the food trucks don't have to run their generators either.
Along the fence?
Yeah, along this fence line. So they pull up and they just pull out their extension cord and plug in. So they're not running their generators. No noise, no exhaust.
What's the construction time
frame?
I'm thinking I'm going to be able to get this built in 6 to 8 weeks. So I've got a facility out on the west end of town over by Patagonia. And so we're going to fabricate all the containers there while simultaneously doing all the site development, putting the foundations for the containers, running all the utilities, et cetera, et cetera. And then I'll just bring the containers in fully fabricated, drop them right into place, make up the connections inside the box, and we'll be ready for that.
And what's your projected date?
It's sounding like building permit-wise, we could see a permit in, well, review comments for the permits within, or by the end of this week or sometime next week, in which case I'll address them and get them resubmitted for permit. And would like to start construction around April 1st.
So this is already a done, I mean, this is a done deal?
No,
this is happening?
Well, it's through the building department, and then the city of Reno has to approve our restricted license. So for city council, it gives our business license to operate, which is tied to our liquor license. We have to get approval from the city.
And when does that occur? Or when do you?
We'll probably on the next consent agenda
beginning of April.
There is, I think, a city council meeting on Wednesday that we are encouraged to attend.
Week from Wednesday.
On Wednesday of this week? This day after tomorrow?
I thought it was this week.
No, it's next.
Are you on that agenda?
I haven't been notified that this is on the agenda, but I'm sure that we'll be there for them looking forward.
In the beginning of a city council meeting, there is an open area where people can speak about whatever issues they wish to speak about. At some point, this will come up on the city council agenda, which shall be usually available like 3-11 months, the Monday before or Tuesday. So it's like we really got to watch it.
Well, we checked it today, and it's barely as under the
Okay.
The other thing is that when we were at the MAC council meeting here last week, they said they would have put it on the agenda for a month. So,
which
kind of the MACs.
Oh.
So, in about 3 weeks, they're going to have on the agenda.
What again are these platforms here?
These are existing walls. So this is the exterior wall. This is just for reference. The
exterior
wall.
Okay. Got it. I got it.
And
okay.
Then this is the sky wall.
I just clarified.
So the highest point on this whole thing is
19.
So it's two high cube containers on top of each other. And this doesn't impede anybody's view out here. And this one doesn't impede anybody's view over here.
Right.
It's basically for the entrance code.
Right. So this stacked container up here is basically just long-term storage. So you walk through the portals for the in entrance and exit. And then this container here is also long-term storage.
Oh.
Landscape. It's going to be pretty.
You see green.
I mean, you said the trees are going to be
zero
permanent,
escape.
Right?
No.
Well,
trees are permanent. So it, just one other quick little thing, you'll see these green things, just to be clear what that is. What that is, it's a zone planning requirement to break the vertical and horizontal planes. So you can't just have a flat wall.
Right.
So we put those in there to do that. And what we're going to do is be planting hops, probably fast growing vines, kind of goes with the motif, but planting hops. So we'll have green walls, living walls, all over the whole perimeter of this thing. And then on the fence.
In this, the fences are going to be like reclaimed wood or something?
Yeah, so I've got artistic fences going to be building the fences. And they have pallets, bulks and bulks and bulks of old cedar wood, cedar and redwood. It's weathered and warped and just got a lot of character, really cool. So I'm going to be building those fences with horizontal slats. You'll have a 1x6 and a 1x4 and a 1x2, and I'll put them on opposite sides of the post. So the fence really has some depth and some character. You'll be able to see through it in spots, and it's just going to be really this low, and I might incorporate some of this material in other areas too, but we've also got some old rusted out wrought iron. So this is going to be a low, 2 foot, 3 foot of the seating area here. So it's it mixes up the materials and gives it a different view from the aesthetic standpoint.
Kind of like when you have all the dwellers, when you have the little fencing around the
right. Yep. So as far as plantings go, this front area here is just going to be a big circular planter. But I'm also going to put a foundation in here for sculptures. And it'll be powered and it'll have gas to it. So if somebody from the area wants to bring down a burning man sculpture, it breathes fire for a couple of miles. You know, maybe we'll run that occasionally.
Yeah.
I don't want to pay a gas bill for 24 hours a day to be blowing fire in there. But there will be an art sculpture piece here at the front entrance. We've got planter beds all along Sierra Street, all along your guys' driveway here on the back side of this container, all along here in front of the bathroom, so you're looking down with some plants all along the back side here. In the bike storage, I don't know if we can talk about that, but we've got a storage area with bike racks, so you can ride your bikes down and park it, secure it there. And that's also a nice buffer too between National Landing and Chuck's patio. Then we've got some landscaping here on the inside along these containers, and then a lot of landscaping along the way as well.
I remember you mentioning that you were going to let artists do murals in the containers or something.
Yeah.
So
from the outside, obviously, street field, zoning codes, etc., we have to maintain a cohesive, clean aesthetic look. On the inside, however, we kind of do whatever we want. I know that some of the distributors, for example, a lot of medias, they do a lot of cool murals and stuff. Or you guys have seen the Blue Moon mural on the wall over there. They've talked about maybe wanting to paint some of the front of these containers, look different and stuff. We're still up in the air on whether we're going to let them do that. But that's something that's worked with an incubation from a local artist to do that. But as far as the VIP containers, the back of the VIP containers, after the restrooms, the vending, all that's open space. It's fair game. A lot of it will normally be open, with the awning open so you can get in and out of it. So it's not a total huge blank canvas, but there is a lot of space where we would be happy to let people come in and paint up the container.
How important is this ambient music thing to you when there's not a band playing? None of the breweries I go to, most of the bars, they don't play music. And of course, if we all have our own windows open in the summer, we won't be able to hear it.
Right. I mean, it's not a deal breaker. It's just more of an ambiance thing. I mean, it kind of creates the scene there. But if it gets to the point where we're having to turn the music up so loud to be able to hear it, then we're drowning out people, and people are trying to talk over the music, and it becomes a problem. The music gets shut off.
I just want to go out and sing to my own.
Well,
sometimes I like
all wired in.
I don't want any crowd noise.
Right.
And I love my band, but see someone use it all the time.
Right.
From down from the field park, well, it's all, isn't it all right?
No.
No?
No.
No.
It's literally under our window. No.
Yeah. What do you think of that? Do you like it? I've
been there so long, I just...
What are the other things that
you have? A lot of civil drawings and structural drawings. I mean, I've got some detailed drawings of the individual containers that are kind of curious about those. They're all pretty straightforward. So, you know, this is going to be open to public walk-in, whoever left it for us, and on, you know, in matters day. But we're going to close it up, come 8 o'clock at night, kick all the underage kids out, and it's 21 and up venue, which should help some of the concerns there, but, you know, it's also operational risk management thing for us. So we'll be doing ID checks and stuff there. And then if there is a special event, whether it's a concert, whether it's a play or a dance performance or a, you know, whatever it is, that's when we'll be doing the ticket checks. And then again, if we, you know, put the space out for private corporate events, receptions, you know, fundraisers for charity, things like that, where it's just not open access to the public, that's how we control entrance in these spaces. So our typical bar layout, this is a decent isometric of the bar. On the end that has these double doors is going to be a built-in cooler, and the actual refrigeration unit for that. So the cooler will be built about 7 foot tall on the inside, which seems to be about 2.5 feet of open space above it. That equipment will sit in that open space, so there's not coolers and compressors and stuff running on top of the thing that A, look ugly, and B, make a lot of annoying noise. So those will all be contained within the container, taps through the wall. This back bar will be like glass under-counter refrigerators for canned beers, bottled beers, stuff like that. There will be no glass on this site. All cups will either be reusable plastic cups or aluminum pints. So you can join a mug club and have a mug. You can, you know, pay a deposit for an aluminum cup, and if you want to take it home with you, you can keep your deposit. But there's no trash. We're not throwing away a million plastic cups. We're not having any glass in the venue. So there will be broken bottles and stuff either inside or on the surrounding sidewalks. So just your normal kind of bar set up in here. In the back of the house, back here will just be, you know, your basic sinks and your storage racks and stuff like that. Front elevations of these containers, you know, the door to get in, obviously, this is the bar top, the countertop. With this awning, you know, they'll close down and secure it. So everything's secured, everything's completely lockable. And the perimeter of the property itself is fenced and locked up at night. Now, can I stop people from jumping a fence? But, you know, is this going to be something that we abandon in the winter when we're closed for 3 months and it becomes a, you know, a banger hangout? No. Right, this is going to be a well-maintained, well-supervised operation here. The containers themselves, back to that, you know, the whole feature. We're kind of just showing placeholders here. I'd ideally like to put like a static TV over here that just has all of the listings for that bar. And then on this container, another big TV that, you know, when we have Summer Olympics going on, when we have the World Cup going on, when we have, you know, football season, you can go and you can hang out outside and watch games or whatever, and if that's not going on, we'll do something else with it where we can do art displays, digital art, you know, we can do different things like that.
Well, I have a question about trash disposal. When the bars are done, they're close enough, where are they going to put all the
Yeah, that's a
We're building a trash enclosure right over by the one that's already up.
So it's going to be
in
the parking lot? Or?
So it's right on our property along the driveway.
Like behind the
yeah, so it's like directly across your guys' driveway from where trucks is.
What's the name of the
Eddy on the river?
Yeah,
you know where it's like swirls and it's
yes.
Tall.
Yes, and Eddy.
Yeah.
Because there's a place in the town called the Eddy House, which is for kids to basically, so it's like a halfway for kids to basically, you know, when they help runaways and stuff. I thought they might have something to do with it because it's not enough to know that
Eddy. It's a play on the river.
You guys have a website for the whole project?
My fiance is Slack.
What was your question?
Was there a website?
Oh.
Project.
No, what are the projects that you've done in the city?
Can we look at?
Projects that I've built? Of course. The boys at Grinding Creative are about a month late getting my website relaunched, but that'll be up. It's got a bunch of the custom homes I've built on it. I've probably done 10 custom homes, $1 million+ range typically. And then the commercial stuff that I've done, if you're in the airport next time, I built Squaw Valley's retail outlet in there. In Midtown, I'm building Noble Pie's new pizza parlor and bar, as well as a bar next door called King and Bottle. I've done a couple of like medical testing labs, stuff like that. So mostly like commercial. My background is in large commercial construction. Spent 12 years in Colorado, 7 of which were building hospitals and schools and, you know, high rises, large scale commercial.
Yes, they did a picnic over here.
Yeah.
You went to the Performing Arts Center?
Oh, yeah.
I used to work.
Oh, okay.
That's the best in the world.
It's beautiful.
And, yeah.
It's an impressive world.
It is.
Yeah, so I lived on 16th and Glenarm, and then I lived on 16th and Flair.
Oh.
It's right there.
And when did you move back?
In 2012.
Oh, quite
recent. Yeah. So I left in 2001, came home in 2012, and trying to do some things that are good.
It is almost 8 o'clock.
Okay.
We've gone for an hour and a half, and really pleasant, I think.
I'm just hoping that everyone.
Oh.
Hi!
Hi, everybody!
Hi!
Hi,
you've come just in time!
Oh, my God! You're just so
do
funny.
You know any of the artists? Have you had an opportunity to meet any other than, like, obviously, you know, Damien?
Yeah,
I
met Damien.
And who else?
Bonnie. Thank you.
Oh, Bonnie, who was here? When did, okay.
So we've been in touch quite constantly since the last year.
So, I really think, I mean, there's some good points about it, there's bad points about it. I'm like almost in the middle of that because I'm not like 104 or 100 against. There's some things that we're just going to, you know, if it gets put through, we have to wait and see what happens. But personally, the thing that I'm really looking forward to if it does happen is the fact that we have a lack of communal space in this building. And if we are invited to utilize that to the fullest of this building, maybe it's our chance to get our act together as a community and finally do something. You know, put on shows, put on art shows. I mean, like, basically, like, what we're going on here, except actually invite them. You know, you just get more involved with things. You know, that's the thing I'm really looking forward to. I'm trying to be positive about this.
Yeah, I hear you.
I'm trying to. So, you know, I mean, the part that I'm most concerned with is the after-hours noise, just like everyone else. I live right here on the west side. I know it's going to be noisy. It's just going to happen. It's just going to be going around it. It is. So that's my biggest concern is the noise. I'm trying to build a video production studio in my loft, and if I got tons of people, you know, making lively rounds of conversations, I don't know if I'm going to be able to go through those plans. It's just me personally. So that's my biggest concern.
Well, you know, I mean, I can say this 100 times, and you guys can believe me or you can't, but there's, you know, it's either going to go through or it's not, and if it does, you know, you're going to have to take me on good faith that we're going to be good stewards of the community, we're going to be good neighbors, and, you know, we do have to run a business, but at the same time, we can do certain things and make operational concessions and work with you guys to be as minimal of an impact as possible. I mean, you know, there's certain things that we are restricted by
sure.
law and by the city code and everything else, but we're not trying to come in here and be like, ah, we beat you guys, crank up the music, it's go time. I mean, that's not who we are, and I don't want the headaches of you guys being pissed off.
No, and that's
not realistic.
Well, and I did have a couple of messages from a couple of people who couldn't make it. One person, I forgot the person's name, I said, I don't even know half of the people that live in this building yet because we don't have a communal space. So one person said, he's for the project, he doesn't see any problem with it, and so he said he wanted to make sure that he said, please make it noted that not everyone is against it, so he wanted to make it. The other person that I know, same thing, you know, she's totally like into club music and Skrillex and stuff. She was actually seemed kind of disappointed that that wasn't going to happen next door. So, you know, I just wanted to put those two voices out there because they asked me to. So they're going to be
here.
I feel my obligation for that.
Yeah.
Reno developed in some cool new ways. I've been staring at a dirt lot for a long time. Like I said, I've been to the one, I'm pretty sure the same one you talked about in Austin. We did the similar ones in Portland. Yeah, and the more Reno starts to become like Austin and Portland, the better Reno is going to be for everybody, our community. So, you know, Midtown needs to start encroaching on downtown. I think this is a pretty good step in that direction because downtown's still kind of a shithole. So the more we can start to get, I think, you know, cool, hip, new ideas into this area and really start to, you know, change what people think of Reno as being, the better.
Well, and you know, that's really what we're going for. I mean, this is Phil and mine's hometown. We chose to live here as adults. I'm not going to do it. I mean, this is something that I want to see my city develop and progress and get better. Next on the docket, taking down some of those shithole motels.
Oh yeah.
You know, you know, I mean, that's just kind of the direction that this city needs to go in. It's the direction the city council's been talking about wanting it to go in. And, you know, it's tough for us that, you know, we're running up against some roadblocks here, which is to be expected. I mean, I can't blame you guys for your concerns and your feelings on the thing.
That's
all
it
totally
is. It's just an opportunity to hear and voice, articulate what those concerns are. So they're not, you know, abstract in any way, but that we've all heard them. We've seen the plans. We've, you know, had an opportunity to interface, ask, you know, as in-depth questions as we can, you know, with where the whole process is. So I appreciate you guys, both of you, coming and doing this and, you know, and just beginning the dialogue with us.
We'll be available as I'm going through the corner of the hallway. It's good. No, it's going to happen to us.
No, of course not. Of course not.
And the plan is to get a contact list with every one of us that's there. See who wants to do this. The touch base is happy to stay in the space.
I got more to
do. Whoever our attention is,
we'll swap the recording.
Yeah.
It's just the way I know. And, you know, people are quick to this is at least an important opportunity. Present the idea. Some of us, this is the first time we're hearing about it. Others have been hearing about it. Damien, thank you for giving us all.
Oh, you're welcome.
You know, I'm telling you,
it's a good thing. You're never being cats.